Hello everyone, I will talk about Google Plus Sign-In, and this talk is called Google Plus Sign-In Plus Plus because there's a little bit more to that than just the sign-in part. First of all, why I'm giving this talk. I was attending to a boot camp by Google, and after that I was talked into giving a talk at the boot camp of the DroidCon in the Seabase space station. And then I was talked into doing it also here because there was an empty slot because someone couldn't come. This is relatively new stuff. Google announced Google Plus Sign-In on the 26th of February. So I'm not really an expert on it, but I can give you some information. First of all, why should we do all this? Like, entering passwords on mobiles is really not pleasant. I don't know if any of you knows Heise. There was recently an analysis by Heise that a lot of users did enter their password wrong, and now they introduced fuzzy passwords, and they saw that it's mainly happening on mobile platforms. So they introduced fuzzy passwords as a way out of this. And you possibly have a user loss because, I don't know if you know, sometimes you install an app, then you see you have to do the whole create an account stuff, and then you just drop this app because you don't want to do it at this moment. OAuth is a way out of this. I don't know who has implemented OAuth. Quick hands, like stay up hands with who has enjoyed the experience. So really no one. This is not really trivial. OAuth 2 is better than OAuth 1, but it's still a pain in the ass to do that. And also, when it comes to security, the less code you write yourself, the better, because it's easy to do something wrong, and you don't see it by a crash or something like that. So it's better to like rely on code of professionals for that. Also, you get two-factor authentication and security alerts, all that stuff that Google is giving for free when you use that stuff. And also, you cannot lose password databases and get really bad press with it because you don't store the passwords, you just store tokens. Also, you get low install friction. You get the ability to install OTA and gain some users with that. I will show how that works later. Then you can access the Google Plus profile and the social graph. So you can greet the user with the name, and you don't have to implement this whole profile stuff by yourself. And the user doesn't have to enter his profile name and upload a picture 100 times for each app once. Then you have interactive posts, which is a really interesting thing. So new users can discover your app and directly install your app, for example, from the web. Then you get engagement analytics for free. Don't get it wrong, it's not Google Analytics, it's something in Google Plus. And you can connect your Google Plus page and get analytics of how posts were shared and so on. Then you can also use this method to auth to other Google services, like for example Google Drive, or Google has a bunch of APIs. You just specify another scope and then you get access to that stuff also. Now a bit of demo time. I do it with screenshots because the network here is also a bit flaky, so it's better to not go for the demo gods. That's what you get when you implement it from the website, and I show it because it has implications for the Android side, because then you can install for the web. When you sign in, that's the first thing you get. You say what circles you want to share, but you can also choose only you for the circle, so just the sign in and don't expose your social graph. The circles are not really shared, the circles, so you don't know if it's the asshole circle, you just get all users in the circles. So that's this screen. After that, if you haven't installed the app already, you get this very interesting screen. And this is like when you install an app from Google Play, the app is installed over the air. sorry for the German text there, but getting the screen again is a bit pain, so it's just the same what you get from Google Play, but you can trigger it from your side, and that really lowers the friction that people don't have to go to the market, search for your app, or have a link there, and then you can. And that's how it looks on Android. Obviously, you don't get an Insta dialog then, but that's how you sign in there. And here you see some details. That's the moments we will get to later. You can share with that. So, how do we do that stuff? First of all, you have to open the APIs console. Perhaps a lot of you know that because when you want to interact with Google APIs, you have to use that. There, you have to enable the Google Plus API, obviously. Then you create, if you haven't already, an OAuth2 client, client ID, and fill out the stuff. Select Android there, that's important. Fill out the details. These details is the stuff which is in the dialogues I showed before. So the user knows which app it is authorizing to. And then you have to use KeyTool to extract the SSH1 hash and fingerprint and also enter it in the console so that you're authorized. And don't lose your key. Always do key backups. Very important. The next thing is you have to download the Google Play services. 6 is the most recent one. And then add it as a Google Play, add this Google Play service as a library project from this path. It's very important to do it as a library project. A lot of people did it wrong and just included the jar, then you get runtime errors. Do it as a library project. The next thing you have to do, you have to add permissions. I don't obviously only if you don't use these permissions any at all before. First of all, is get accounts. So you can choose an account because you can have multiple accounts on the phone. So you can choose which account you want to use. Then you obviously need some internet because you have to talk to the Google service. And you need the use credentials to revoke tokens. The next, some tips. It's very important to enable logging because otherwise stuff will fail very silently and you just wonder what happened. For example, if you write a moment, it doesn't tell it's wrong, that you haven't specified this activity type, it just fails and you don't know why. When you enable logging, it's not crashing, but you see it in the ADB logcat. And this site is very handy to get documentation. So now, finally, some code. When you want to support older version, you have to check, because for the Plus client, you need Flojo and above. And then you can check if the Google Plus app is installed and degrade gracefully, or like show the user in dialog to install the app that you get with Google Plus util with this line, get error dialog, and then the user can install the app. Now some more code. That's the activity. You can also wrap this whole life cycle in a fragment. The most important thing there is the Plus client, this instant, because that's the handle you need to do all the Plus interaction later on. Next is very important, like to you initialize the Google Plus client, obviously. These activities are the app activities or moments. They have the name is not really clear. You have to specify. I talk about app activities later. And this is the scope I was talking about. Here you can also add scopes like Drive or other Google APIs. Now you have to handle some connection callbacks. Here you resolve errors from the connection. And for example, also, if the user chooses another account, disconnects the account, that's an error, and then you can connect again. And finally, the is unconnected callback gives you a callback when you are connected, and then you can like show the user, hey user, find that you are here. Then you can, that's not that important for him. Then you have to add a button to actually log in. There is already a button as a layout in the Google Play services for signing in. It's very important here that you also need a sign out button. The term of services say you need a sign out button also, but there's no layout for that yet in the Google Play services. The Google engineers at the bootcamp said it will come, but they were not sure yet about how and like the style of that. And then you register a callback to this button and to this code to actually do the connection stuff. Show the progress dialog, and yeah. It was, as I said, it was for the bootcamp. That's why so much code is in here. On success, you dismissed the dialog, who is the progress dialog to show the user he's finished. We are finished. And then say user is connected, or do whatever you want with that, or put a crouton there. That's the sign out part. As I said, you have to use a normal button for that, or ask a designer to do your button for that. There's no default button for that now. You just clear the default account, you disconnect, and then you connect again. That's like kind of a trick, because then this whole error resolving, getting a new account is done for you. Here, this is the disconnect from Google Plus. It's a bit more than sign out. Sign out, you can do a circle of sign out, sign in, sign out, sign in. Disconnect is you really disconnect the user account from your app. And there, it's very important to also apply to the terms of service to remove the data you got, because like the image and so on, after this is successful, after you really disconnect, you should also remove the stuff you got, because you have no right anymore. Now we come to really using the app. This is an interactive post. You perhaps knew before there was sharing with Google Plus, the normal share intent, and this got a bit fancier with that. You have an interaction part, and it's this little button here that's called the verb there. You have different verbs. If you want to have more verbs, you can file it as a bug. The main thing is they have to translate it to all languages. There's like buy and a lot of verb, like over 100. And as I said, you can request some more. You can pre-fill this dialogue in there. And the big pro is you can get users to install your app, because there's also this Insta thing. If other users see this interactive post in their timeline, they can click on it. And if they are, if they have already installed your app, they are brought into the app with a deep link. I will show that later. Or if they haven't installed your app, they are brought to the marketplace. They can install your app, and afterwards they are brought to the deep link. So you lower the barriers of installing, because a lot of users just get distracted. Oh, I have to install something, I forget it, and so on. Yeah, that's for sharing a Kifu. That's like a Go recording. This is how you implement that. It's fairly easy. There is a builder pattern for that, and you just pass the needed stuff, like create item is the type, the URL in this case, the deep link ID, we pass that later when we get that as an intent extra. And then you just create this post. It's fairly easy. This is how you pass that. That's what you have to add to your manifest. I think most of you are Android developers, so you should know that. It's an intent filter, and you get this common Google Android apps plus a few deep link you have to catch. And then you get your deep link ID. And you pass it like that. It's just you extracted the deep link ID from the intent. So now moments or app activities. There's a bit of a wording fuzz, but basically it's there was a big outcry that users wanted to have a write API to Google Plus. There was a read API for a long time, but users wanted to write. Google has a bit of a problem there because they don't want the timeline to be spammed. I'm not on Facebook, but a lot of people say on Facebook it's a big of a problem that there's a lot of apps writing in the stream and it's a big mess and so on. Google doesn't want it because they also don't want to undo things. They just want to give things out and don't take it away afterwards. So if they have put an API out, they don't want to rework it. And so they are very, very slow with that stuff. The app activities is kind of a write API. The only difference is it's not directly going to your stream. It's going to a special place. You can share it to your stream afterwards, but it's not directly visible to other users. They can look for it. Yeah. You shouldn't be spammy with these things. It's always hard to get a real balance. They are not also not really telling how much is too much, but don't too much, don't do too much, don't spam. You can also read and delete these items with your app, so you can use it as kind of a storage or syncing. Google, most of the time with these app activities, you pass an URL, and Google is parsing the schema and using the values from there. So it's best when you are like backed from a server where have a web page. You can do lots of this stuff also without a web page, but that's kind of buggy, and we experienced at this bootcamp some problems with that. With UL, it was working all the time, but as I said, it's fairly new stuff, so there are some pitfalls. It's best when you have like a server in the back. That's how it's looking on the Google Plus side when you have connected some apps. And it's also good to install some other apps to like see how they implemented it. That's like TuneIn is one of the examples, the radio station. And they share as a moment if you like listen to one radio station or another. This Gus stuff is also public. It's from Gus Klaas, one of the Google engineers who were at the bootcamp, like also a test site. And this is my Go game sharing stuff. And this is how you do it, how to list those moments. You get a callback for the on moments loaded, and then you like can pass all the moments, get a next page token and so on, so you can read all these moments. Next thing you can do with all this stuff is you can add a plus one button. That's your how you add it to your layout. Just this little plus one button, you know. And then you have to implement that. You just find by ID this plus button, and then you initialize it with also with your plus client and the request code. It's for the on activity for a site stuff. Next thing is you can retrieve some user information. Me is a special keyword here. That's for the user itself. Otherwise, it's the ID you know from Google Plus. It's this long ID nobody finds. But you also get this ID when the user has granted you access to some of his circles or like parts of his circles. Yeah, and then you get this also because it has to be asynchronous. You get this callback when the person is loaded, and then you can extract the data like the username or an image. The image is a bit bad because you have to fiddle around with the URL to get it in different screen sizes. There's a little regex you can use, but there's no default stuff yet, but this will come later. Yeah, that's basically it. I hope I could give you some information and it was a bit helpful. Questions?
If there are any questions, I'm happy to work.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ligi.